That's it. We just want to win for our team.
My goodness!
Just as good as men. We're better.
It's a huge point for the Bay Area.
Good chance that's the number one highlight of the week.
Welcome back to Major League Table Tennis. My name is Ryan Willard, and I'm going to be totally honest. I'm on live TV right now. We're on Fubo and Amazon Prime. And I don't even know what to say because this weekend here has been insane. This is day three of week 12 at Major League Table Tennis here for the Eastern Division. And over the weekend, we saw the number one team, the Carolina Gold Rush, clinch the number one seed in their division. And then we saw the number two team, the home team here at Rider University, clinch their playoff berth. So we have our two teams who will be going to the playoffs and the championships next month in Chicago. But today we have even more amazing table tennis action coming to you live from Lawrenceville, New Jersey. So we're gonna start things off and we're gonna bring our umpires out right now. So first and foremost, please welcome your umpire, Jovana Nazevic, and who will be assisted by Walter Lamb. And of course, your very first team. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the Florida Crocs. That's Daniel Gorak, Benjamin Brossier, Matilda Ekholm, Daniel Gonzalez, and Mark Duran. And today they will be facing the number one seed in the playoffs. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the Carolina Gold Rush. That is Enzo Anglais, Romain Laurent, Kai Zhang, Jeremy Hazen, Hong Lin, and Bastien Dupont. We have some amazing table tennis coming to you right here, right now. So let's get down with the get down and shake hands, teams.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Lawrenceville, New Jersey, on the campus of Rider University. Has alumni gymnasium been a wonderful sight this weekend, or what, for this March weekend of East Division action, Major League Table Tennis? Our Sunday doubleheader commences with Carolina and Florida meeting for the final time during the regular season. The Carolina Gold Rush clinched the top spot in the East Division last night. Princeton Revolution have clinched the two spot, eliminating the Florida Crocs from playoff consideration. So we know who's going to the championship weekend. But we got one more match to play here in the East Division regular season. We're excited to bring it to you, and we welcome you to our broadcast perch, Evan Lepler, alongside Matt Hetherington. And Matt, it's been an exhilarating weekend. There were 12 golden points played yesterday across the two matches. We saw the first ultimate golden point of the year, the first one since December. Princeton celebrated, Carolina celebrated. Now it's time for closing statements for Florida and Chicago to see if they can close their season on a nice note.
Yeah, and I think both teams have come into this with the mentality of they're going to fight through to the end. It's kind of echoed in post-match interviews we've had with them. My hope is that we see them kind of loosen up and relax and just get out there and play their best table tennis. I think we're going to see some of the best rallies of the season today out there on the table.
We have seen an interesting lineup change from the Florida Crocs, and we'll show it to you right here for the first time all year. Matilda Ekholm is not playing doubles with Daniel Gorak. Matilda is playing singles alongside against Kai Zhang in the third single spot. We'll begin with a matchup we haven't seen since September. Daniel Gorak will take on Romain Lawrence in the first single spot. That's all coming up as we get the action rolling here from Alumni Gymnasium at Rider University. MLTT, Carolina, and Florida. First serve on the other side of this quick break.
Representing the Carolina Gold Rush. He's played second in the French Championships. Please welcome Romain Laurent!
2 minutes warm-up.
And in the green, representing the Florida Crocs, the five-time Polish national champion. Please welcome Daniel Gorak!
We are just about set for the start of Sunday action here in Major League Table Tennis. Romain Laurent for the Carolina Gold Rush taking on Daniel Gorak for the Florida Crocs. These two players went head-to-head back in September. They have not played a singles match since, so it's been 6 months since the last time Gorak and Romain played 3-11. Gorak took 2 out of 3 on that September Saturday. 6 months ago. Gorak, the number 2 pick in the first MLTT draft. He's had a good year, certainly a better first half of the season than the second half.
First game to play.
Romain Laurent has been a solid number 2 player for Carolina all season long, playing in the first singles spot here today. And here we go. Final Sunday of the regular season in the East Division. Laurent to serve first. Reminder about the format, 3-11 and 4 separate singles matches and also 1 doubles match. Each game to 11 is direct to 11, not win by 2, each game worth 1 point. There are 15 total points up for grabs leading into the golden game, which is the culmination of every team battle. That's worth 6 points. And yesterday we saw 2 epic golden games, Matt Hetherington, 2 all-timers.
1.
Yeah, and to see the top 2 teams in the division go all the way down to the wire was pretty unreal, especially here in front of a home crowd.
1-3.
So Gorak off to an early lead here. Romain typically tries to play a lot of forehand. You can see him stepping around there to play forehand off the backhand corner. Gorak, he's such a quick player. It's going to potentially cause some problems for Romain. I think, if you want to play a full table forehand game, the last thing you want to play against is someone who plays quick, really quick, explosive shots.
But what, if any, adjustment would you suggest Romain make here to have the best chance?
I think a lot of short play. If he's going to play long, it has to be heavy or really deep on the table, but also to play that cross angle, if he can get Gorak out onto the forehand, it kind of cuts off that diagonal angle to the backhand side. Yeah. Oh. See, this is not what Roman wants at all. If he plays cross court, to be able to step around on a ball that's going that wide is really difficult.
Two, 7-2 lead seven. For Gorak. Strong start for the Polish standout, who now resides in Clearwater, Florida. Olympian in 2016 in Rio.
Seven, three. Crocs.
Yeah, this time,
seven,
Laurent's targeting
four.
That forehand diagonal. The wider he can get the ball to break on the table, the more chance it can come back to his forehand.
Four, eight.
8-4 lead for Gorak.
Four, nine.
Wow, big step around forehand from
five.
Roman Laurence.
He's been waiting for that. Firmly in control with a couple of serves here to try and wrap game one.
Wow. Down the line,
nine,
winner.
Six.
Half-hearted behind the back effort there, Gorak. Strong turnaround here from Roman Laurence.
Nine.
Wins both points on Gorak's serve. Now he's got a chance to tie this thing back up if he can hold serve on his account.
Gorak's certainly been no stranger to a comeback effort this weekend.
Seven.
Net post.
Ten.
Began, of course, Gorak, 8 of the first 9 points against Jishan Liang in the Princeton match. Jishan ran off 10 in a row. Ultimately won the match 2-1. Jishan did with the golden point in game 3. Gorak.
11,
a strong
seven,
overall
three,
performance
seven.
To start this Sunday for Florida. 11-7 in game number one over the... Match number 22 of the season for the Florida Crocs and the Carolina Gold Rush. Gorak picks up where he left off on the opening point of game number two.
Ramon's placement on that ball. Straight into the body of Daniel Gorak.
Now, we don't know exactly what the format for MLTT will be in future years. Will there be expansion? Will there be a change of number of games and number of overall matches? How the Golden Game is orchestrated? We don't know.
Two, one.
But today is the final day for these East Division teams, particularly Florida and Chicago, to wrap up what they've done, to put one final bow on their seasons. Certainly Florida has been solid in the Golden Game department, solid in the doubles department. Singles is where the Crocs have ultimately fallen short.
Yeah.
Began the day 115 singles game wins, 137 losses.
Three.
Every other team in the East is at 500 or better. To see Flint Lane, his trusty sidekick John DePaola. Amongst the fans in the stands here in Lawrenceville.
Gold Rush.
Had some pleasant weather here in southern Jersey over the past few days. Sunshine. Comfortable.
And picking up the aggression here in game two. Got to take those forehand opportunities when they present themselves. There it is again. Ramon just doing a great job of targeting that forehand cross court. The diagonal angle on the table is a little bit longer in terms of shot trajectory, so usually when you go cross court, players much more safe playing the cross court angle back.
3-6.
Laurence very much wants to stay on his forehand, so the more he can play that cross court angle, the better. There's the link for the Major League Table Tennis Fantasy League, fantasizer.com.
6-4.
Form your own fantasy team of eight players each weekend of competition. We've had great fun throughout the season between us commentators. I would like to say friendly competition, but you know, there are some barbs. Some bobs around that.
7-4.
Friendly barbs.
Yeah. Certainly would encourage anyone to get involved with that if you, especially if you've never done, I'd never done a fantasy league before in any sport. And there's never been more table tennis. So this was like the perfect opportunity for me to get in on it.
Will you be filling out a March Madness bracket?
No.
Men's or women's college basketball?
No.
That could be your next
I know nothing
next adventure. That sometimes knowing nothing is better than knowing everything. The crazy thing is, that's 100% true.
6-7.
I think I'll stick to the table tennis fantasy until you wear me down with your statistics on win rates.
The irony is, despite your full season blather, you know, five straight weekends in a row, my table tennis fantasy team has outscored you. You, with no knowledge of college basketball, might fill out a better bracket than I would. I stopped filling out brackets about a decade ago for college hoops, just because I'm going to watch all the games anyway. And, you know, it would drive me crazy when someone would, you know, root for one of the top favorites just because they had them going to the Final Four
You got to root for the underdogs. You got to root for the chaos and the drama and the Cinderella stories.
Yeah.
You know, separate your. But it's it's hard to separate your own personal. You know, oh, I have $10 on the line. Okay, forget about that $10. And just cherish the moment. Gorak back within one.
8-7.
There from Gorak. Ball drifting half long, just over the edge after one bounce. Lawrence got the cross court angle he wanted for the forehand counter, but just not there with the execution.
Here's a dumb question.
Eight.
I don't think I've asked you one yet this weekend, knowingly. This one is knowingly. Why do you say half long instead of long?
It's just to distinguish the difference between a ball that really bounces deep on the table and one that just kind of falls over the edge. It's significantly harder to attack a half long ball.
First yellow card of the day comes early. Not even 11:30, and the Gold Rush are sitting on a yellow. As Lawrence flipped his paddle in frustration after that miss. More of a spike than a flip.
I must say, he's been having quite a bit of frustration out there on the court this weekend. Probably a lot more than we would usually see. Half long.
Seven.
I mean, we used to practice them and we call them knuckle busters because they drop off the table so close to the edge. You have to commit to your shot, but you also have to be extremely careful because, you know, we've seen players hit their thumb on the edge of the table, and when you're swinging hard, it can definitely do some damage. Oh, Gorak, he had the chance to close it out.
We got a golden point here. I do have a follow-up question on the half long vernacular, but we'll get back to it because the weekend of the Golden Point continues here in the Garden State.
The gift that keeps on giving.
Gorak serves. Double game point. And Gorak has a 2-0 lead.
10.
As the frustration continues to climb for Lawrence. On his serve, Gorak sets the tone. Handles the short return and takes game two by the slimmest of all margins. Daniel Gorak has 2 points for the Florida Crocs already on the board. Now he'll seek the sweep against Roman Lawrence. Matt, what stood out to you about the way Daniel played that golden point on his serve?
I think primary objective for him is, you know, he served a little bit no spin. Trying to get Roman to pop the ball up if he played short. Played out exactly as he wanted, and the first thing that he did was drive that ball to the backhand side of Roman. Roman going for the hand switch forehand.
2-0.
Doesn't land it.
I don't remember seeing a hand switch forehand all season long, except in my own tennis matches when I try it rather than my backhand.
I don't. I don't think we've seen one in Major League Table Tennis. Maybe today. We're gonna see one go on the table first.
One
quick follow-up on the half long. Do you call it half long because the receiver is genuinely not sure whether the ball would bounce a second time on the table?
Yeah. Yeah.
Two, and three.
That's what makes it. It kind of creates a hesitancy among the receiver.
I mean, because if it's not going to hit the table, you have a little bit more time to handle it.
Yeah.
But it's the second time.
Four.
It's obviously a double bounce. You need to attack it quickly.
Yeah, it's a tough ball to attack. It's become a lot more popular in table tennis because,
Crocs.
You know, if somebody serves long, and it's actually long, it's much easier to attack with a lot of power. But if the ball's half
Four,
long,
three.
It's you kind of have to handle it a little more delicately, and it's been much more common in players setting up big counter attacks. They kind of try and get the player to open soft, and then. Roman looking a little bit off here today. Not quite landing his shots.
Switch sides with Borak up 5-3. Carolina choosing not to take a timeout. It is early in the team match.
3-5.
We got some interesting matchups coming up. Azin and Gonzalez played in November. They have not played since. Azin swept Daniel 3-0.
Yeah, style matchup wise, that's one that Jeremy will probably like a lot. I don't know if he's actually lost a match before to Gonzalez.
Best point of the match for Roman Lawrence, without a doubt.
Things up at 5-5. A lot of movement around the table there, but ultimately, Roman stays on the forehand, drives it home. Said yesterday when the Princeton Revolution won against Carolina, it's the first time they've ever lost to two teams in one weekend. If the Crocs win this, it will be a blowout for Carolina. I mean, they'll still walk away with the first position in the East Division, but
not the ideal way to go into the postseason. And there's 6 weeks in between now
Seven.
And the championship, so. Does momentum from mid-March carry over to late April? I don't know. They certainly will have a long time to think about this. It's a great point.
Roman looking
Six,
to
eight.
Steal away game three here and get a point on the board for Carolina.
Gold Rush were utterly dominant in the interdivisional weekend in Rock Hill. So that should give them some confidence going into the West. Against the West teams at the championship, however, obviously the West teams were not at their
Six,
best
nine.
In that weekend. And certainly some questions that still need to be answered. Roman Lawrence, after trailing 5-3, has won seven of the last 8 points here. To set up a game point to salvage single point for the Gold Rush in this opening singles match.
How about that? Gorok stayed alive with the backhand block and spin. Takes a bite out of his paddle in defeat. But Gorok still victorious overall. He wins two of the three games. But look, that's an important point for Carolina, and particularly for Roman Lawrence. Had a tough weekend overall. But a strong closing statement for Roman as he takes game three, 11-6. Daniel Gorok wins two out of three games over Roman Lawrence to start this Sunday competition. Daniel joins us now. Daniel, congratulations. A strong performance for you. What were you most pleased about for the way you battled Roman today?
Good morning, guys. I know Roman for the long time. We play one time in the Major League. Then I know how I'm supposed to play. I'm doing my tactic all the time, and it works for two sets. And in the end, I missed maybe too much, and he won the last game.
And how was your team's preparation this morning? I mean, obviously, you're coming into this match without a chance of making the playoffs now. I know both teams, every team still wants to win, obviously. How does your focus shift at all? Do you feel a little bit more relaxed, or is this still all guns blazing?
I'm trying to be relaxed all this weekend, but if you feel the pressure, then of course it's very difficult. Today we have nothing to win instead of maybe some money and good results. For sure we fight for each point, and I'm trying my best, but just maybe today I look a little bit more calm, but also I'm a little bit tired.
Daniel, on that last point, we saw a little spin move after one of your shots. It ended up not working out, but is that something you've been working on, that spin move from the backcourt?
The 360 lob.
I don't know. Maybe I didn't play so many balls like that, and he surprised me. He surprised me to receive this ball, and he won the nice shot.
Daniel, thanks for joining us. We'll see you in doubles just here in a little bit.
Thank you.
Hazin versus Gonzalez for the second time this season. And Gonzalez takes the opening point. Hazin
1-0.
Defeated Daniel 3-0 back in November. 11-7, 11-8, and 11-10. So all three games were reasonably tight. And Gonzalez off to a blazing start here.
2.
Yeah, stylistically an interesting match. Gonzalez is a pretty aggressive player. Jeremy Hazin much more steady and controlled.
1.
Less of a power player, but excellent placement.
2-2.
See these players competing in the US quite a bit. Gonzalez from Puerto Rico, Jeremy from Canada.
3-2.
I don't think there's been a game all season where every single point's been won by the server. Maybe this is that game. Darn.
Oh, maybe
three,
not.
Three.
is almost poetic.
So close. And Jeremy Hazin takes the lead for the first time.
One of the big factors in this match is obviously for Gonzalez to keep up his aggressive game and maintain power. He needs balance. He needs good positioning and balance. And Jeremy just so solid on the backhand defense and the counters, but
three,
he just moves
five.
The ball around. He has very good awareness of where his opponent is on the table. Gonzalez misses the cross-court forehand counter. 6-3 for Jeremy Hazin. Jeremy's a pretty animated character on the table.
Yeah, he wears his emotions on his sleeve every single time he's competing.
Just spent almost a month in Saarbrücken in Germany, one of the top Bundesliga clubs, practicing to prepare for the Canadian Olympic trials.
5-7.
Helped him take two out of three games over Tim Wong here on Friday. Hazin was inactive yesterday, but back in the Gold Rush lineup this morning. Gonzalez is far his way back within one. Nice shot by Gonzalez.
7-8.
Cross court, right on the line. And the Florida Crocs are back in front in this opening game.
Timeout,
Gold Rush. Singles, and Carolina is going to hit the pause button. Alex Yang is going to have a chat with Jeremy Hazin. Timeout for the Gold Rush.
不是，你这个球你接发球没有必要接的这么凶啊，接发我上来。很难说。不是，放上去等一等，然后发你正手球，不要去摆短，你可以立起来搓出去，搓到大脚反手位，对不对？你发完球往他正手短的话，你全发到反手现在，你现在没有必要发长球了，你发到短球有效果，然后再发长球。因为正，切不好。侧手往侧上正手位短的发呀，发完他不让你反手你就是他，他正手你拉他，然后你正手低板出手稍微正点稍微高一点。
可以。
Recognize any of the vocabulary there, Matt?
No, it's a Sunday morning, Evan. It's tough for me on a regular day.
7-8, Gold Rush.
Alex and Jeremy, Coach Alex Yang and Jeremy Evan.
Oh, he missed it.
They've built a pretty good coach and player relationship beyond MLTT, but also long before it. I know Jeremy's been visiting Alex Yang's Atlanta, Georgia club for many years on and off over the last decade. Coach Yang actually went for the last week that Jeremy was in Germany to help him prepare as well, so.
Game points for Gonzalez.
This is the opportunity. And it looked like he stopped at the end of that shot.
Seven.
Nazine again fights off another game point.
10. Timeout, Crocs.
And now Frank Arias going to take a timeout. Two timeouts within the span of 4 points.
Porque tengo un tiempecito más de pensar tu jugada.
I just barely knew right now. This is insane.
Su vaca no es tan peligroso, pero la pone. Ahí él te la levantó ahorita. Ok, se gírate un poco la muñeca antes, pero tranquilo. Vaca igual, seguirle con tu vaca en paralelo hasta que tú tienes la oportunidad de virarte y atacarlo. Y atacarlo yo creo que al medio.
Vamos.
You guys ready for the end of this game right now? Well,
pressure's on here.
Borak said it simply and in language that we all understand.
9-10.
Two more chances.
Gold
you need
rush.
Just one. You're in the driver's seat.
Yep.
Yikes.
10.
Oh. 10. Definitely not the serve receive he wants.
But it's tied.
Does have the serve in hand. For the golden point.
That's right, make the noise. Oh.
Gonzalez serving at 10-all. Oh, goodness. It caught the edge. Gonzalez apologizes, but also claims game one with that strong effort on golden point. Some big swings from Daniel Gonzalez, and the Puerto Rican takes the opening game against the Canadian Jeremy Hazin. Florida Crocs officially eliminated from playoff contention yesterday.
Second game.
When the
Gold Rush to serve.
Won
zero.
Their golden
zero.
Game 21-20 against Carolina. Angela Guan over Holmes in the final ultimate golden point. And a strong start for the Crocs on this Sunday morning. Three out of the first 4 points, including
one,
a couple of golden
zero.
Points going the way of the DG. Daniel Borak and Daniel Gonzalez.
See Jeremy.
0-2.
And back to what he does best, working the angles. Lots of wide angles. Loves to block the ball corner to corner. Try and get his opponent off balance. Gonzalez has done
two.
A pretty good job of handling it so far. These are physically tough rallies to be involved in.
3-1. Good stuff from Jeremy Hazin to start game two.
4-1.
Gonzalez set up that ball so well. Got the counter attack in, but you've got to be really careful when you're playing Jeremy Hazin. When you play with power, not to hit at his racket. This is so steady.
2-4.
think the players that have had the best success for him have really tried to play angles that break the table off the left and right side. If he played within the confines of the table, kind of down the center, Jeremy can just hold the table, stays very close. That's a good example of that right there.
Jeremy reacting like he lost the point, but he won it.
Like I said, he's a very animated character.
You won the point, Jeremy. Come on now.
Six,
soft
two.
Opening loop, clips the net. 6-2 for the Canadian.
Six, three.
You could get a pretty good reel of Jeremy Hazin's slow-mo facial expressions from the season.
Seven.
Be a pretty good game. Show the facial expression and ask, did Jeremy win the point or did Jeremy lose the point? And finally, Gonzalez hit around
four,
the wall.
Seven.
Kazim is doing a pretty good impersonation of the wall. Finally, Gonzalez finds the angle.
Jeremy can only smile at that one.
Seven, five.
Gonzalez on a bit of a run here. Counter opportunity.
8-5.
You can see Gonzalez is really pressuring Jeremy's first opening shot to try and get a softer loop. Giving himself a lot of opportunities to counter attack.
Five, nine. Six, nine.
Jeremy just talking himself through the motions. What a forehand counter
nine,
from
seven.
Gonzalez. Long serve over the forehand edge. It's a great serve setup to use against a left-handed player. Just breaks the corner of the table.
Fun point there. Gonzalez catches a break. The net ball stayed in, and it's a one-point game.
Again from Gonzalez,
nine,
just
nine.
Stepping it up here at the end of the second game.
The reality is neither player has a timeout to use the rest of this match. You only take the one timeout per the match. So each coach using a timeout in game one. It's up to these players right now to try to get to the finish line on their own. Nine all, Gonzalez serving. Big chole from
nine,
Hazin.
Ten.
It's a huge point to the gold rush.
Gonzalez really went for broke on that one. Lost his balance a little bit.
Oh.
A service error.
11-9, ends the second game.
Ends the game, I should say. Prevents us from another golden point. Hazeen evens up this singles match, one game apiece. And they'll play one more to 11 to determine the winner. The season now, Jeremy Hazeen and Daniel Gonzalez
third
have
game,
five
Crocs
different
to serve,
games
0-0
across two matches. Hazeen has won four of the five games, but all five games have been close.
Wow.
0-1.
Jeremy just as patient as ever. Gets that early forehand counter and gets quite a lot of pace on it. Usually the earlier in the bounce you hit the ball, the more acceleration you can get. Takes
one,
the time away from
one.
Your opponent. Tell you, time's a precious commodity in this sport.
What's the best measurement scale for time in table tennis?
Usually
tens of seconds.
Yeah, the usually the reaction time is 1/10 of a second, and that's across a 9-foot surface. So it's kind of the sport that personifies blink and you'll miss it.
1-3.
Why I love some of our slow-mo replays, because
yeah.
You just
appreciate
it in a different way. The level of hand-eye coordination, the angle with which players adjust their wrist, adjust their paddle, the footwork. An interesting doubles match coming up.
Yeah.
Enzo and Hong Lin against Daniel Gorok and Mark
Duran.
What's your first impressions when you see that pair on paper?
I'm going to be really interested to see how Mark Duran plays in the doubles, because I know he's been quite successful with doubles in Spain, Spanish national champions. Stuff like that, but in singles we see him back off the table so much,
right?
And play all kinds of interesting shots. So
can't really do that.
Five,
the
two,
same way.
No, you back off the table and you're kind of shooting your partner in the foot more than anything. So yeah, it will definitely be interesting. I mean, Enzo and Hong are such a great pair. It'll be interesting to see how they, as a mixed doubles pairing, go against a men's doubles duo. Six-two lead for Jeremy Hazeen. Goes for the wide angle and misses.
There have been nine team matches this year where there's been a men's doubles team versus a mixed doubles team. That's 27 total games that have been played, men's doubles versus mixed.
6-4.
Men's doubles have won 11, mixed doubles have won 16.
I imagine Cole and Rachel Sung are probably a factor in that.
Seven, four.
Frustration boiling over there for Gonzalez. Azeen closing in.
Five, seven.
Gonzalez is very much in striking range here in the third. 2 points behind.
It was a big point right there that he just won.
Yeah, always good when you have that moment of frustration to come back and win the next point. Helps you settle back in. And what a point from Gonzalez.
Seven.
Plays that backhand down the line. See, Jeremy was stepping across again.
Seven all.
Seven all.
Spoke too soon when I said Hazeem was closing in, up 7-4. Gonzalez takes the lead.
Eight.
Oh, he had the opportunity for
eight.
It. Sure. Bit of a fade on the serve return. With the serve. You could see just
nine,
the small
eight.
Changes in placement from Gonzalez. Three forehands in a row, just moving closer and closer to the middle. Jeremy had to try and adjust his backhand positioning. That is an excellently constructed point there from Gonzalez.
Nine,
Jeremy comes
nine.
Back with a big serve return.
Yeah, that's a huge point there. Hazeem with two serves coming up at 9-all.
Nine,
11-10 in game one, 11-9 in game two. It'll be one of those scores in game three. Two or 3 points left in this match. Little cat and mouse there.
Hazeem
gets the game point first.
Presents the opportunity for a golden point.
Crocs are 2-0 on golden points so far today. One of them earlier in this match. Crocs also won a golden point against Lawrence. Gonzalez serves. And Gonzalez airmails it long. So Hazeem escapes with 2 out of 3 for the gold rush and evens up the team tally.
3 points apiece through two singles matches. And it's a win for the Canadian lefty, Jeremy Hazine.
Ladies and gentlemen, arriving at center court and warming up right now, in the green, representing your Florida Crocs, you're a five-time Polish national champion who is once ranked 52 in the world. Please welcome.
We are back at Rider University, the Florida Crocs and the Carolina Gold Rush. Jeremy Hazine just won a golden point to take two out of three. Jeremy, I mean, this, you could call it a dead rubber, but certainly the passion and energy on the table with you and Daniel felt like there was a lot on the line. First time you played him in a while, three really close games. What in your mind was the story of that match?
So actually this match, of course, my opponent played a really good match. And I wasn't expecting a lot of the stuff that he did, because last time he played completely different and his strategy was also completely different. But I think this time he really changed and I don't think I was ready for it. Actually, I don't know why, but really this match I couldn't really keep my focus, because actually every single set, regardless of who won the set, if you look at every single set, even starting from the first set, I always was leading by a margin of at least 3-4. So I think when I was leading, I think I took it too much for granted and I started playing passive. But okay, he's a good player, so if you're gonna play passive, you cannot expect to win at this level. You have to earn every point.
And I mean, you've obviously had a lot of good results against him before in the past. I don't know if you've probably won every time, right, I think?
No, I've lost to him before. But okay, of course I won like more than I lost, but yeah. He actually beat me like I think 2 times. Yeah, in total. But I think that it doesn't matter what happens in the past. So every match is a new journey. Regardless of the result in the past, every match is a new adventure. So.
Well, we got a new doubles match coming up. Jeremy, thanks for joining us. We'll see you in the Golden Game. Men's doubles for Florida, mixed doubles for Carolina. The first time all season the Crocs have tweaked their lineup and taken Ekholm out of the doubles spot, giving her a chance to play singles today. We'll see her in singles against Kai Jong coming up.
One, all.
But certainly a lot to think about. You mentioned the stylistic choices Duran has made playing singles. Mm. That's a good reach over the table smash.
I have a feeling we're gonna see a very different Duran playing this match.
How does this change for Gorok and his mentality?
Well, obviously he's playing with a right-hander instead of left. So there are some positioning and footwork changes that have to happen compared to playing with Matilda. But I think Duran will probably be a lot more aggressive. Obviously, Ekholm tends to open slower and spinnier. Duran's got pretty compact and sharp strokes. So. Yeah, I mean, anytime you change doubles combinations, you lose some advantages, pick up others. Hong and Enzo have both the left and right-handed combination. Also, Hong being panhold and short pips is stylistic. Interesting shots thrown into the mix there in that point.
Yes, indeed.
Duran with the no look. Well, I guess we will still see some Mark Duran flair from him. That was returned by Enzo with a 360. Enzo looking as sharp as ever. Just catches the back edge.
3-5.
We'll see Honglin back out here today. She certainly took the Golden Game loss against Princeton yesterday quite heavily. You know, I spoke to a bunch of the players after the match, and they said the main reason that she was so upset was because she felt like the team had really pulled everything together, and being able to fight back like that, she was in a position to close it out for them. And I think a lot of expectation riding on her, especially given her previous results against Angela in Golden Game.
Swing and a miss from Duran, and the Gold Rush back in front here in the opening game of the doubles.
Just doing a great job of setting the ball up for Enzo's attack. Very consistent. Steady forehand flicks, great placement.
7-5.
Enzo having a chat with Gorak across the table. Too good from Carolina. Tricky serve there from Duran.
Game points now for the Carolina pair. Mixed doubles combinations continuing to prevail here in MLTT.
And they take game one, 11-6. Zoe and Honglin have been the best doubles team in the league all year long. Carolina now 51-13 in doubles games for the season. Carolina takes its first lead of the day. the first time today that overall one-loss record projecting 0-0. Carolina victory in the 22nd and final match of the season for the playoffs that are coming 6 weeks from now in Chicago. Matt, how would you assess the movement and teamwork of Duran and Gorok playing doubles together for the first time through 20 points or so?
I think it's okay. Obviously not on the level required to win the first game. It'd be really tough. Knowing how to set your partner up and knowing how to move around them well or what shots they like. It takes a lot of repetitions to really figure out your partner and to form a good doubles team. So, you can have two really exceptional players. You can have two players who are really good at doubles. But when they play together for the first time, it can still be really tough. So, we'll see.
Four,
I mean, good start in game two so far. So they've obviously had some discussions to try and recalibrate here. So remember, we have the order change. When the players switch ends, they'll play to the opposite player they did in the last game. So this time, Mark Duran playing to Hong.
3-4.
See Chicago and Princeton have arrived. Back corner.
5-3. Wow. That point had a little bit of everything.
6-3.
To be expected when someone like Mark Duran's in there. This time, Gorok just sweeping the ball up.
7-3 lead now for Duran and Gorok here in game two.
There's Jishan Liang watching his wife play doubles along with Koyo Kanemitsu. Sure, they had a great celebration yesterday evening.
8-4.
Having secured their playoff position for championship weekend. I think last night's match was by far Princeton's best performance so far in this season. Pretty electric stuff.
Hong Lin catches Daniel Gorok off guard there. And here Enzo saying, we are there. They get this point, they'll have two serves. They could be right there. I think there's just something different about this combination of players on the table in doubles that, if you look at the corner and see members of both Princeton and Chicago looking on, there's intrigue as to, this is something they haven't seen before.
6-8, let's play.
Players on Princeton and Chicago have obviously competed against all these players, but not in these combinations.
Enzo goes for a big backhand.
And sails it wide, so a slew of game points here for the Crocs. Even up this doubles match at one game apiece. Not yet.
10-7.
That's what we want. That's what Enzo has just said to Honk. Solid forehand flick there from Honglin.
Long chat for Enzo and Hong before even going over to the towels.
Their way back to within 1 point deficit.
Good stuff from Honglin and Enzo. Certainly the more experienced pair playing together after this long season collaborating. It was 10-6, now it's 10-9. Enzo sends it hard into the
11,
net, and Florida survives and takes game two by two. So the team tally is 4-4. This doubles match is tied at a game apiece. The lead going into the intriguing Ekholm-Jong singles matchup will be decided by this next game to 11. Alrighty, game three. Enzo Anglais and Honglin for Carolina. Daniel Gorak and Mark Duran for Florida. 22 matches. This is the 21st time Enzo and Hong are playing together. Doubles. 22 matches for Florida. This is the first time that Gorak and Duran are playing together.
Oh, that ball just rode the net at the end there.
1-0.
Enzo having no problem dealing with that.
I mean, it's
wild
fun.
Backhand slice.
It's fun to watch Gorak and Duran scramble, but it doesn't feel like that's their best method to success.
Yeah, not really. I think, and a lot of the reason that I think Hong and Enzo had such a strong start in the first game is because Enzo's not really too fazed by all of the variations that Duran can throw at him, whereas I think Hong was a little bit thrown off by it.
0-3.
So it'll be important for them to get a strong start in the first half. Players will change ends at 5, and the order will change again.
4-0.
Hong's forehand flick game has been solid throughout this doubles. sets a winner against the serve of Gorak there. And they'll get the exact start that they wanted. 5-0 as the players cross sides of the table. The order switches. We have a mixed doubles on one side here. We're about to have a mixed singles in game number three between Matilda Ekholm and Kai Jung.
One-way traffic right now here in game three. I've seen several firsts this weekend. You mentioned Carolina losing twice in a single weekend for the first time. You also saw Enzo and Hong lose a doubles match for the first time against Jishan and Angela here yesterday. Do you think there's something with Jishan and Angela that will, I mean, some spark that of chemistry, camaraderie that will continue for them? Do they figure something out in doubles this weekend?
I mean, they must have figured out something because they played much better than we've seen them together throughout the season. I think, yeah, a lot of it's just figuring out how to set up Jishan's attack, distances from the table. I think small details. Oh, that is a wide angle. And so ends up on the floor trying to go after that one.
One.
Up 8-0 and still diving for a ball.
First point on the board.
On a dead rubber. How about that from Hong Lin, just whipping it down the line. We have not seen too many games this lopsided all weekend long. It's really been a splendid weekend competition. All four teams really going hard. But this third game in the doubles, 1 point away from being a convincing Carolina victory. And there it is. So Borak and Durant win game two, 11-9. But it's a 9-point win in game three for Enzo Anglis and Hong Lin. Carolina has a 5-4 lead as we get excited for this mixed singles match that's on deck. Enzo Anglis and Hong Lin victorious in a doubles match for the 20th time this season. Enzo, you have gone 21-1 in doubles matches this year. Congratulations. What was different about playing Mark and Daniel as opposed to Matilda and Daniel?
I want to say nothing special because we won, I think, all against Matilda and Daniel. But the only tricky part is that because there is two men in front of us that only want to play stronger or harder and then make mistakes. So that's, I told her before, it's not because there is two men with a quite good level in front that we need to play stronger than usually, right? So she didn't, and she put the ball on the table. We were very aggressive. We were really playing together from 0-0. And I don't know why, but this double for me was very important because to keep the dynamic also before the playoff and everything, all the games are very important. But I think she suffered a little bit from yesterday's last point, right? Mm. So I think it was good to just come back with a win like this and against two players that wanted potentially to give her a lot of struggle with high balls, backspin balls, yeah, side spin balls, and they didn't succeed doing that. So
since you brought up yesterday, what was your message to Hong Lin after the final point yesterday?
It's sport, you know. At the beginning of the season, Angela lost 8 out of 8 in the golden game, and Hong Lin saved us 3-4 times in the golden game. So, you know, this is sport, and we win, we lose. We fought until the end. Yeah, 2020, it's her, but it could be me too, you know. So it's not her responsibility, it's our.
All right, Enzo, we'll see you in the singles. Thank you. For the first time this year in a singles match, Matilda Ekholm versus Kai Jung. And Matilda takes the overall point, aided by the net.
Yeah, I mean, this could be an interesting match. I mean, Matilda, she's played some outstanding golden game points against some of the male players in the league. And we saw Jung Kai kind of struggle a lot throughout the weekend to find the right rhythm. I mean, okay, Koyo played outstandingly against him yesterday. It was a very tough match for him.
One, but two.
The strength here for Matilda is that her first openings are quite hard for male players to counter because they drop low quite quickly.
Two, two.
But hopefully we see some great play here from Matilda. She's a fantastic server. See a lot of direction changes, hook shots, inside outs. She did say post-match after the doubles yesterday, she's not the fastest player in the league, but she likes to think she might be one of the smarter and more strategic players.
She said table tennis has been her life since as long as she can remember. Time winning the national championship in singles in Sweden. Also won several doubles championships too.
I must say,
three, four.
You know, obviously, I met Matilda after I came to the U.S. But Matilda's Olympic story is one of the most, to a degree, heartbreaking, but also inspiring stories.
Right.
I mean, she qualified for maybe two or even three Olympics. I think two Olympics for 08, Sweden.
12.
Yeah, wasn't granted the right to play by the Swedish Olympic Committee, and just kept going and
finally got to compete in 16 in Rio.
Yeah, and the crazy thing in 12, I think she won the World Olympic qualification, which is not an easy tournament to win. Still didn't get the chance to play.
Grew up in a small village called Vikingstad in Sweden.
It's a pretty cool name for a town.
Played table tennis and soccer growing up. She said she was better at table tennis, so she focused on table tennis. Kai Jung has the lead for the first time here. Well done by Matilda Ekholm. What do you think's percolating in Kai Jong's mind right now, Matt?
It's gonna be a little bit of pressure. I mean, there's usually, you know, when men's players come up against women's players, there's the pressure comes from the fact that the women's players are quicker. They play closer to the table. They play shorter, sharper shots. You know, a lot of topspin driving.
Seven,
so the pace is difficult to deal with. But with Matilda, it's slower. It's a slower pace. Lots of wide angle breaks. And a lot of pressure receiving serve against her as well. Her reverse pendulums are really well-developed serve.
That's a shot that just Kai Jong, if he's connecting, can be successful for him all the time.
But, yeah, at the same time, I mean, Kai should feel really confident. I mean,
7-9.
Won so many tournaments on the East Coast throughout his career against the best players in the country.
This is just the 13th time in over 80 MLTT matches that we've seen a mixed singles showcase.
7-10.
There's that reverse pendulum serve. Wins the point outright for Ekholm.
Game points for Kai Jong on his serve. Carolina takes game one.
11-8.
Ekholm trying to guide the ball down the line there.
Lead umpire took a yellow card. She didn't present it though. Until it gets the yellow for that little paddle flip at the end.
Like they have given a yellow card. Not sure if they did give a yellow card to
second game.
Matilda. There is one sitting
serve,
on the,
0-0.
The scorecard of the assistant umpire, Walter Lamb, on the side of Matilda.
One, zero.
Any major adjustments that either player needs to make in game two?
I think Kai just needs to play with more control.
Yeah. Did that catch?
Did clip the edge of the table.
Oops. 0-2.
Matilda just had a facial expression that said, I'm not so sure, but I'm not going to win any argument now.
Yeah, I think the major adjustment is to control. I mean, yeah, Kai plays really explosive attacking game, but he needs to pick and choose when to play soft. Like I said, a lot of the men's players in the doubles as well have struggled with Matilda's slow topspin play to counter, especially Jishan, when we've seen those doubles combos pair up against each other. So you have to choose when it's smarter to block the ball. Right, good timing
five,
there. Good
zero.
Connection from Kai Jong. Table, not
zero,
a great start
please.
For Ekholm.
Yeah. The most successful female player in these mixed singles matches has been Jong, not Kai Jong, but Lily Jong,
of course. She's had some outstanding matches
playing for the Bay Area Blasters.
Seven.
remember the Pleasanton weekend, winning against Rabatte and McDonald in singles. So you can see, I mean, we talked really early in this team match about half long. You can see Kai serving half long. He gets a softer opening from Ekholm that he can counterattack.
Three, seven.
It's one of the tricky things about serving half long is where the first bounce goes as well.
Wow.
Three,
Ekholm's got to be careful. The strength of her first opening is that it stays low and kind of dips. She doesn't want to kick the ball up too much, especially against a player with a forehand
like Chiang
Kai.
Zhang's forehand just disappears when he drills it.
It's
by you so quick. Quick release too. He doesn't wind up like some other players. He's not like Jishan or Enzo.
Yeah.
It's like just a powerful flick, and man, he crushes it.
Yeah, there's the
10-3.
Smart decision from Zhang to just get on top of the ball and block. Don't let the ball drop below the table.
11-3, second
goes
game.
Goes to Zhang, 11-3. Much more comfortable margin in game two for the Carolina player. And the Gold Rush now leads 7-4 on the team tally. Zhang has a chance to guarantee Carolina a lead heading into the Golden Game if he can complete the sweep.
Carolina has now earned 7 of the first 11 points in this Sunday morning affair. Matilda Ekholm trying to salvage a single game here in this singles match. Kai Zhang 11-8 and 11-3 victorious in the first couple. Shots like that just taking control of the match.
She's based in the New York area.
Two,
National Coaching
one.
Director for Ping Pod. She's very familiar with Kai. She's probably well aware this would be a very tough match coming into it.
How about that?
What a great point.
Mixed in the chop. And then the block down the line to take that big point over Kai Zhang.
She's got to be happy with that.
Oh, Zhang apologetic. That's as perfect of a netball winner as you can have in terms of just ending the point quick. I suppose you could institute a rule. You know, if that was the serve that landed that way with a couple quick bounces, it would be a let. Should there be a return let?
No.
Should you have to return it onto the table without connecting with the net?
they actually thought about doing away with the serve lap rule.
Sure.
It was trialed in the German league probably 6 or 7 years ago now.
4-3.
Let serves wouldn't be a thing. But that idea died away pretty quickly, I think.
I've watched a little bit of college tennis mm-hmm. over the past couple of years, and there are no lets in college tennis.
Yeah, I didn't know.
They play every single let in college tennis because I think at one point, you know, they don't have the technology to. So it was just too many arguments. Was it a let? Was it
right.
not a let? So just play all lets.
Yeah, I know. In pickleball, it was also a thing, and at least, well, recreationally.
Play all lets in pickleball.
Yep.
Do you think it would be a good trial to if MLTT decided we're gonna play all lets or?
No, I think there's because the ball is so small in table tennis, and it can drop so close to the net. I mean, net and a pickleball net have significantly more height.
Sure.
A table tennis net, sometimes the ball can hit it and just drop, and it's impossible to retrieve.
7-4.
Wait. Ekholm still keeping herself pumped up out there. She wants to play her best table tennis. Produced some pretty stunning rallies here and there.
8-4.
Tough ask to compete with a forehand like that, though.
There's nothing you can do about that. Cool. And this ball just disappears off his paddle. Pretty good backhand from Ekholm.
5-8.
Oh, are you kidding me? Can you believe that?
9-5.
It did not look like it was going to catch the whole way, and it just kept coming back to the table and then grazed it on the way down.
I really can't believe that went on.
We'll show that to you again.
10-5.
The long rally. I want to show you the live action, of course, too, but maybe going to break. I mean, Kaijong did not need the help of the table tennis gods necessarily.
Ekholm goes for the round to net.
11-5 in game three. Kaijong completes the sweep over Matilda Ekholm. And the Carolina Gold Rush have guaranteed themselves the lead heading into the golden game. Still have Enzo versus Brossier. Two Frenchmen set to battle. Welcome back to Rider University, where Kaijong just swept Matilda Ekholm 3 straight games. Kai, the first ever meeting against Matilda in a singles match in MLTT. What was the mindset going into it? How'd you feel about your performance?
I'm pretty happy that I could win 3-0 at the end, but before the match, to be honest, I was pretty nervous, you know, because I mean, she has a very good serve, and also her timing is a little bit different than mine. And I play her, I think, in Miami, like the Golden Game. You know, I lost actually like 3 points, then I won 1 point. So that match actually I took pretty seriously, yeah.
And what kind of adjustments did you have to make? I mean, obviously you talked about her timing. We've seen a lot of the male players in the league struggle in the doubles because her first loop kind of dips a little bit. How do you change your game to make sure that you can get those counters in? I mean, I saw you kind of slow down and block some a little bit, but you also managed to get her to kind of kick the ball up more so the bounce was higher.
Yeah, so basically when I serve, I try to just serve more top spin and sometimes like half long, sometimes short because yeah. I know she got trouble with that one. And she can't really make a lot of spin on that top spin serve. So I think on my serve, like I don't have so much problem, but like on the receive, I try to keep my eyes open, you know, and watch closely because she's like changing a lot, like by hand, forehand, yeah. underspin, topspin. So I try to like push longer so I can avoid, you know, like the spin basically. And then I try not to counter loop every ball. I try to block.
Yeah. Interesting perspective. Appreciate you sharing. Congrats on the 3-0 sweep. We'll see you in the Golden Game,
yeah,
Kai.
Thank you.
Nice to hear a player addition to our conversation about half long serves.
Yes, indeed. For the first time this year in a singles match, Enzo Angles versus Benji Brossier. Enzo's the top player in the league, so he's obviously considered a favorite. What do you view as Brossier's chances here? What does he got to do to stay in it against Enzo?
I think serve returns. Really one of the important factors against Enzo. I mean, you need to stop Enzo really early in a point. I think one of Enzo's biggest skills is how he compounds into a point. He makes the first opening attack, and then he just builds on it. So for Brossier, it's about pressuring the first opening into the rally, trying to take the initiative himself. Usually if Enzo makes the first attack, you've really got to stay on top of it. And Brossier does.
3-1.
Kind of similar to Mark Durant, we often see Brossier backing away from the table. Is that a problem against Enzo?
I think it would be. Enzo, he plays a lot of sharp angles, especially wide to the forehand against right-handers. So, you know, if you end up really far back from the table, the angles only get more difficult to deal with. So, you know, if you're at the back barrier, that wide forehand angle is going to cut into the corner of the court.
2-4.
But also, like I said, you know, if Enzo makes the first attack, you've got to put pressure on him. It's really difficult to pressure someone when you're backed off the table. You know, if you really want to keep good pressure on them, you have to be close.
2-5.
Brossier will need to win at least one game here to keep the Crocs' hopes alive going into the Golden Game. If the Carolina Gold Rush get a sweep here, it'll be 11-4. It'll be guaranteed the majority of the points on offer here. Having said that, at this stage, the points the points count less now than they have earlier in the season.
Enzo Angles letting it rip.
7-2.
There you can see Brossier backed halfway up the court, just not able to apply enough pressure. Wow. That combination of shots from Enzo.
2-8.
Such a quick change of direction.
Too good.
2-9.
The battle of the short ball. Brossier finally sends it long and Enzo's ready for it.
9-3.
Brossier duels him in that rally.
Brossier, when he can get in with the forehand, really solid in a counter loop rally, especially on that cross court angle. So trying to block his way through that point. Garcia keeps up the offensive. Still trails by four here in game one.
Big fist pump from Angles as he sets up game point. And that'll do it for game one.
11-5, first game.
Enzo Angles took 2 out of 3 points in the doubles. He's played in the first singles spot more often than the fourth singles spot this year, but no difference. His level of focus and precision. 11-5 for Angles in the opening game.
Second game,
to Wichita, Crocs 3 weeks,
and 0-0.
6 weeks from now, championship weekend in Chicago. Game two between Brossier and Angles underway. And Brossier takes the 1-0 lead.
1-0.
Had a great, great audience last time we were in Chicago, so look forward to seeing who shows up for the finals. Certainly if some of the matches throughout the season have been anything to indicate, I mean, the Portland crowd, even Pleasanton, and fans showed up for Lily Jung, and here in Lawrenceville, New Jersey, for the Princeton Revolution team, we've had some pretty electric audiences.
1-2.
Enzo thought that ball was cracked, and it sounds like he was correct. Get another ball from Walter Lamb. Brossier backing off the table pretty quickly there.
What do you think about the rule change for championship weekend? To make the golden game matter in every single game, no matter what. You see Angles go around the table. Don't see him go down the middle.
What? Oh, what a point.
Fighting his tail off, but Enzo with just too much quality.
As if Brossier didn't do a good enough job of returning that round the net to start the point. Look at that backhand counter.
Major League Table Tennis deciding to shift the rules in that the golden game is not necessarily worth six,
like it is during the regular season. The Golden Game is worth everything at championship weekend. But unlike the regular season where you can only have a maximum 5-point lead going into the Golden Game, now you could have a lead as many as 15, theoretically, if you won 15-0. So, did you like that change?
Yeah, I think it makes sense. I think a lot of consideration went into how they were going to approach this. Obviously, you know, when you get to another fantastic rally here from both players. Enzo backed off the table. Brossier takes it.
Yeah, I think,
you know, obviously we've had a kind of round robin format that's based on points. You get to a bracket and the points are not as important. It's about who wins and who loses.
Let's play.
Removing that cap from the Golden Game definitely makes sense. Brossier, big forehand counter. He's 5-3 in the lead here in the second game.
What's changed here in game two for Brossier?
Brossier's looking more aggressive. It's a little bit more punch in his shots. We've seen even on the occasions where he's been backed off the table, he's tried to reclaim that ground by moving back in.
Wow.
Putting the pressure on Enzo.
3.
Frustration brewing now for Anglais in a way that we don't see very often. Obviously, he holds himself to a very high standard. We've seen him win matches and be disappointed with his level. Missed that one too.
3-7.
And Brossier's got a 7-3 lead here.
Pretty hesitant on that serve return.
Yes, indeed.
That's 4, half 7. Long magic if I ever saw it. There's a moment there where he thought it was going long, then decided it might be going short, and then kind of got stuck in the middle. Enzo directing 7, that ball straight at the body of his opponent. Brossier still 2 points in the lead.
Serves here for Brossier. Needs at least one of these two. And we'll get that one to go up 8-5.
8-5.
Both teams have still one timeout left here before the Golden Game.
Tremendous point.
6-8.
Brossier had some lunges to get balls back that I didn't think he had a chance for. Painting the line on one side, keeping the pressure on Anglais, but Enzo, that's just a tough shot to handle. Brossier down on a knee. Seven.
Evan, I know you do a lot of commentary for different sports, so if you look at the championship weekend format, what are your thoughts on this point cap change? Are there any other ways that you would approach it going from a points-based system to a bracket?
Yeah, you know, I can see both sides of the argument as we get a timeout here. Let's listen in.
Yeah, well, it was a great receipt.
Also, I think if you can, if this is good, if you can play this one straight, then you get this. He won't play, and then you can come back more active. Then yes. You can come more, a little bit more active.
Be careful of a long serve to your backhand now. He might try that. Going into the goal game. The goal game
is about to happen after this.
Come on. Just to be clear, I wasn't dodging your question. I just wanted to hear the insight from the Crocs bench. So, you know, we've discussed throughout the year that if I could snap my fingers and change rules of MLTT, there are several things I would like to change. One of them is, I think, if a player wins the first two games of a singles match, the match should be over and they get the 3 points.
Right, so
just
best
imagine
of three.
The leverage of these points here. Now, there's 2 points on the line for both players in this moment at 8-7 in game two. If Brossier wins, he gets to play game three.
Seven.
If Brossier doesn't win, his day is done until the golden game. So that's one of the things I'd like to see change. Another change that I would like to see is I don't think there should be a limit of lead you can have going into the golden game. I think if you're up 11-4 going into the golden game, you should have a 7-point lead at the start of the golden game. And I think I'd feel better about the championship weekend change if that was the case all along. Now, with that said, we have not seen a team win a golden game but lose an overall match, which is to say that anytime a team has gotten at least 11 points in regulation before the golden game, we have seen that team take care of business in the golden game, even though sometimes it gets a little hairy. So, look, will the pressure be different if the team is up 7-0 or 9-0 and they've been dominant? You know, the other team gets a little momentum. Will that change the vibe? I don't know if we're just delaying the inevitable in that regard. So part of me thinks that we should maintain the format we've had all season long, but I certainly understand it. And there are a handful of changes that we could make. Right now, we should probably focus on this big point at 10-9 between Anglais and Brossier. For the record, I also think we should go to deuce scoring, which I know is not necessarily a popular opinion. I understand the gravitas of this point at 10-10, but
I love the golden point.
You know, the point at 11-10 would be riveting too. The point at 15-14, if we got that far, would be fascinating. You know, it wouldn't happen very often, but you could get to 22-21. Like, why not? Anyway, this is the golden point right now. And Anglais missed it, so Brossier evens up the singles match at a game apiece. And that single point does keep Florida alive for sure going into the golden game. Big win for Benjamin Brossier there. One more game to 11 before we go to a golden game for the final time in the regular season between Carolina and Florida.
Hi.
Yes, until the goal game, yes, all together. After goal game, they rested. Before goal game, rested.
Well, a little controversy here. The score is 1-0 because Carolina's received so Roman gets the second yellow card, which is a red, which is a free point for Benjamin Brossier.
0-1.
Matt, can you help us understand what just transpired?
The part that I understand is that the cards are for the team match as a whole, not for the individual match. So the yellow card that Matilda was the Crocs.
Oh, you're right. Roman.
So, the yellow card that Roman got first is still kind of in play.
I'm not entirely
sure what Enzo was yellow carded for. I didn't see what happened right at the end of the last match, I'm sure.
I mean, it could have
some
been
some frustration at losing the.
Could have been frustration. Could it have been coming back late to the table?
It's possible.
3-1.
That's costing the first point of the third game. And
all right, let's go to our sideline reporter, Sean O'Neill. Oh, Sean's not here. Sean, come on, man.
1-4.
So down 1-4, doesn't seem too thrilled with the situation here. Brossier's looking mentally solid right now.
Carolina does have a timeout to use. Maybe it'll be used if he loses this point.
This is interesting. Enzo moving across the serve position, because we spoke about it in his post-match interview after playing Jishan. Now I asked him, do you move the service position to try and capture different angles? And he said no. It's just to do something different so that he can reset his mind. So interesting to see him do that now. Definitely a time when he would need to reset and get things going again.
Brossier
leads at the half. And the players switch ends.
Is there any more draconian penalty another yellow card or another red card? Or would it just be 1 point, or would it be more severe?
It's just 1 point. I think they can some people call it a red card warning, but it's not in the sense of the next penalty is a red card. It's not like a three strike rule.
Right.
They can award as many of those additional yellow cards as they want. Especially in a situation like this where, kind of unfortunate for Enzo to have another player's yellow card impacting his score.
Part of the team game.
Yep. Right now, he's leveled things back up at 5-5.
6-5.
So take a look back here at the end of that game. And a pretty, pretty small racket toss, I think.
That racket toss got him the point penalty.
6-6.
We see it one more time.
There's a lot of subjectivity that goes into umpiring and interpreting the rules. I mean, yes, it's a racket toss, but
I mean, could that paddle toss damage the table?
No, not really.
What's the problem?
Just how the rules are interpreted.
Wow, Brossier catches a break.
6-7.
Are the stars and planets and celestial vibe all aligning right now for Brossier to take two out of three from his French countryman. Should be a pretty big upset.
Brossier hiding less topspin on that ball than Enzo was looking for, and pace as well. Little dip low. Enzo not able to block, and Brossier 2 points in the lead. He looks up. Maybe a high toss serve coming in. Depends where the lighting is. There it is. Dangerously close to the edge. I'm sure Enzo was nervous for a second there.
What a battle.
Brossier certainly making Enzo work for these points. See Enzo knowing that Brossier can counter loop really well on the forehand is just plowing the ball into that backhand side.
Eight all.
Enzo with some style points there on that down the line shot. The no look, throws in a little 360 to recover. Ties things up again. He's gonna have to be on his best behavior. Make sure he doesn't lose any more penalty points at this stage of the game. Enzo recovers the net ball.
9-8.
And then the players get straight back into the offensive. Brossier gets in on the half long
nine,
with the forehand.
9-9.
Nine. This match could go either way. It's been a great display from Brossier. The rallies have only gotten longer, more intense. What can Brossier do here with two serves
nine,
behind him?
Nine.
Place.
Nine,
sets
seven.
Up game point. That ball almost crawled over and then it fell backwards. And Anglais overcomes the point penalty and Benjamin Brossier's tenacity to take two out of three in the final singles match before the Golden Game. The number one player in the league, Enzo Anglais, survives and sets up Carolina with a 5-point lead heading into the Golden Game. That's coming up next.
Recap here of the matches that started us off here. Daniel Gorak taking two out of three over Romain Lawrence. That's where that first yellow card was earned for the Carolina Gold Rush. Jeremy Hazin in the tightest of margins overcoming Daniel Gonzalez. The doubles saw the mixed pairing prevail over the men. And pretty dominant style there in the third, 11-2. Saw a mixed singles between Matilda Ekholm and Kai Jung. A couple of pretty awesome rallies from Ekholm, but ultimately Kai Jung with the sweep. And of course, as you just saw, a rally-packed and explosive match between the two Frenchmen, Benjamin Brossier and Enzo Anglaise. Enzo, 11-9, third game, just comes out on top. Get into a golden game pretty shortly.
We are set for the golden game. Let's figure out what the order is going to be and bring in Assistant Commissioner Mimi Bosica.
Mimi Bosica!
Yay! Thank you. Thank you, Ryan. Okay, coaches, so we currently have the Florida Crocs trailing the Carolina Gold Rush by 5 points, which means Carolina will begin with a 5-0 lead with the serve, and the first pick is Florida.
Mark Duran.
Mark Duran will play first.
Romain.
We'll have Romain Lorenz play second, who will play second on your team.
Enzo.
Enzo Anglaise, who will play second.
Benjamin Brossier.
Benjamin Brossier, who will go next.
Daniel Gorak.
Daniel Gorak will go third.
Kai Jung.
Kai Jung will go third for Carolina.
Fourth.
We have Jeremy or Honglin.
Who they have?
Honglin.
No. Who they have?
They have Matilda and
Daniel Gonzalez.
Daniel Gonzalez.
Jeremy.
Jeremy Hazin will go fourth, which means Honglin will go fifth. Who will play Jeremy?
Matilda Ekholm.
Matilda will play fourth, and fifth we will have Daniel Gonzalez. All right, coaches, good luck.
Thank you so much, Mimi.
Mimi Bosica stepping in to orchestrate the golden game order, because the Commish Flint Lane, who's traditionally in that role, is not going to be at the event in Wichita in a few weeks. And Mimi, I think, gets an A+ for handling this for the first time. All right, what do you think of the order, and what do you expect here in the golden game? 5-0 lead for Carolina at the start.
Some big changes in there, obviously. One of the matchups shifting. I think Jeremy and Matilda is going to be a really interesting matchup. I'm sure Jeremy will be feeling a little bit of pressure there. Hong and Gonzalez. Another great mixed matchup. We've seen the golden game order change to have more mixed matchups in the second half of the season than in the first. I think it was a trend that was kind of trailblazed a bit by Eric Owens when he put Dan Liu in the lineup against Hong Lin. It was one of the big changes made by the Chicago win to try and conquer the nightmares that they were having with the golden game.
Lawrence takes 2 out of 3 from Duran. Reminder of the odds being very much against Florida. Teams with a 5-0 lead to start the golden game this year are 33-2. And very nearly, that caught the edge, and Brossier has had some good fortune at times against Enzo.
Enzo just walking over to the bench and shrugging.
Florida was 1 point away from overcoming a 5-point deficit against Princeton yesterday.
Hey.
7-3.
Bro.
Brossier is flustered on Glace a little bit here.
Yeah, he's done a really good job of driving the ball out wide to Enzo's forehand. Enzo having to cover a lot of space here on the table. That's the serve. Ray John coming in to face off with Daniel Gorak.
Just wonder if there's a little something extra here. A little extra mojo for Florida. This is their final golden game of the first season of Major League Table Tennis.
5-8.
Crocs 12-9 in the golden game this season.
6-8.
Gorak off to a good start here. Could potentially bring the Crocs within chomping distance.
See what you did there.
Kai a little bit too eager on that forehand opportunity. Set the ball up really well, but drove the ball into the net. Gorak one away from a sweep here. And he gets denied it by Jung Kai. Big backhand attack.
That's 9-7.
Jeremy against Ekholm. I mean, Jeremy, he doesn't really have the power to hit through Matilda, but he has good control to move her around. Two lefties against each other. Serve return against Ekholm is going to be really important.
Service error.
Except in this, except in this case.
Seems not to be happy about that miss. Right under his paddle. Wow, we don't see Jeremy Hazine that far from the table very often. Fought his way back.
Big counter on the forehand. Both players kind of flailing on the backhand to get the ball back on. And Ekholm delivers for the Florida Crocs.
Yeah, earns a split.
She's been a solid performer against the male players in the Golden Games.
Go home then, here's Daniel Gonzalez. Hong Lin has been one of the best players, not just females, but one of the best players overall in the Golden Games all season long. Gonzalez has been one of the weaker players. See if that follows through today. Hong Lin was in control of that point the whole way.
Comes to the golden game. Hong Lin's got some records to set clear. Wants to come out here strong today.
She was in the tough spot yesterday. That 20-all ultimate golden point. Played aggressive, sent a ball long. Angela Guan prevailed. Tough one to swallow, though. To sleep through. Back. Too straight to Lin on Daniel's serve. Now two serves for Hong.
Gonzalez with a big attack off the serve.
Unless we get to 20-all, that's the final point of the season for Daniel Gonzalez. And he wins the final 2 points on Hong Lin's serve to salvage the split. Now it's Lawrence and Duran. Final 4 points of Mark Duran's MLTT season right here. Vermont's now won three of the first four against Duran, including the first 3 points to start this golden game out.
Vermont clips the net, but sends a forehand down the line. Carolina Gold Rush getting a little bit of room to breathe here.
Florida's going to need Brossier to step up again against Enzo.
I think Hong definitely redeemed herself by taking pressure off the team here today.
Roman Lawrence locked in here in the golden game. 1 point away from a golden sweep. Duran salvages the last point. It's a 4 point game. Anglais and Brossier return to the table.
She got some clarification on the yellow card situation from Sean O'Neill, which is funny because you were asking for him on the sideline. Second offensive is docked 1 point. The third offensive is 2 penalty points. And the fourth is sent to the referee. Thank you, Sean, for scrolling through the ITTF handbook for us.
Oh, just missed the back edge of the table. Anglais with 2 serves and a 4 point lead. See 2 comebacks from teams trailing to start the golden game this weekend. It's been a rarity. Not just this season, but particularly the second half of the season.
Enzo on the attack.
I mean, Enzo's had some golden games that he's wanted back, but this is a strong sequence here. He's 1 point away from golden sweep that more than likely send Carolina to the finish line. Great stuff from Brossier.
What a point.
That's the final point he'll play in the first season of Major League Table Tennis, Matt. A nice one to end on. See what Gorok can do against Kai Jong. He played well against him last time. Back to a 3-point game. A golden sweep would tie it up. Ekholm and Hazim would face the next 4 pressure pack points. We're going to get a timeout first.
Gorek, kind of.
Time.
I think Kai's feeling the pressure knowing that
15,
Florida
18.
Crocs are on 15 points and closing the gap a little.
Certainly more conviction in those swings from Kai Jong. What did Gorok do before at that timeout that you're about to comment on?
I think he was ready to serve, so the timeout was right as he was about to
time
serve.
Timeout, Crocs.
Now we're going to get a Florida timeout.
I love that little nod of the head from Frank Arias. He's like, yep,
same thing.
I have one too.
I send a kicker. Okay.
Where are my Florida Crocs?
Just you know, if it's if you don't see it, probably it's. So I think go for it. In any case, go for it. In any case, go for it.
Well, the final match of the regular season for Florida and Carolina. I think that's the first time all year we've had timeouts called 1 point apart from one another.
That was certainly a little entertainment factor in that.
19 serving 15, John 2 points away, and that service ace gets Carolina to match point. 5-0 lead certainly looms large, doesn't it?
Carolina closes out the regular season with a 16-5 victory over the Florida Crocs as Kai Jong finishes the Golden Game 21-15. Carolina on to the playoffs and championship weekend. The Florida Crocs, a valiant competitor. They started the season by winning 5 of their first 6 Golden Games. But the Princeton Revolution came on strong. Carolina victorious today. We'll chat with the winners next. He is. Carolina prevails over Florida by a final score of 16-5. The Gold Rush win the Golden Game 21-15, and we're joined by Gold Rush coach Alex Yang. Congratulations, Alex. You finish the regular season 16-6 overall, also 16-6 in Golden Games. How important was this match for you today after not winning the first 2 days of this weekend?
This game match is very important to win and build the confidence back, because we lost 3 match in the row, including the last month. I mean, so I told them, also the player says, we have to win and give everybody confidence, then go to the finals.
And I know you changed the Golden Game order up a lot. If you look at Hong's performance, I mean, obviously last night she was in a really tough spot after the Golden Game. Had the chance to close it out for the team, but wasn't able to. How happy were you with her performance today in the doubles against 2 male players and then again against Gonzalez? in the Golden Game?
Home played so very well today for the doubles and the Golden Game. You know, sometimes it's happened, you know. So after, I think she tell me she has confidence. So,
how are you feeling about your team heading into the playoffs, Alex?
It's not easy, but we will try.
Anything that you'll be working on between now and then?
Yes. Some players will go back to France, to the French National Championship next week. Then Kai is going to Olympic Trial USA next week. Then Jeremy is going to Canada Olympic Trials, so the following week. So that means they always play match, so keep good form, I think.
All right. Well, congrats on a phenomenal regular season. Best in the East. And we'll see you in 6 weeks in Chicago with a championship on the line. Thanks, Alex.
Okay, thank you.
Alex Yang, the head coach of the Carolina Gold Rush, that they were not number one from start to finish because Florida actually got the better of Carolina early in the season. But the Gold Rush finished the season 4-2 against the Crocs. And they had winning records against everybody in this division, and that was they were 4-2 against everybody in the division. They were 4-0 against the West, and Matt, are they the favorite heading into the championship weekend?
I don't know if I'd say they're the favorite. I mean, Princeton are running red hot. Bay Area have stepped up. There's so much that could happen. We don't know who's coming in from the West yet, so as Alex Yang said, it's gonna be tough.
Fun watching the Florida Crocs. Players like Benjamin Brossier battling with everything they've got. Look forward to seeing what the Crocs have in year two. Still got one more match to go this weekend. Princeton and Chicago to cap our Sunday in New Jersey. That's coming up in about 22 minutes. For Matt Hetherington and our entire crew, I'm Evan Lepler saying so long for now. Kai Jong closes out the Golden Game, and Carolina finishes their season on a victorious note. Princeton, Chicago at the top of the hour to cap the weekend here in Lawrenceville.